Hello and welcome to Women in the Word. Today's topic is reasons why people leave the church. At the table with me, I have Anna Ermshar on my right. Anna, welcome.
Thank you. Good to be here.
And on my left is Ki Morse. Ki, welcome.
Thank you.
It's good to have you.
Glad to be here.
I'm glad you're here. Before we get started, though, let's invite the Holy Spirit to come and join us in this very, could be a very touchy topic. And Anna, I'm going to ask you to pray. Okay.
Our dearest Heavenly Father, we thank you for being here with us today, for guiding us through this. Please touch and open hearts to hear your word and your will, and may others be encouraged by what we learn here today. This we pray in your most precious name. Amen.
Amen. Well, as I was prepping for this program, I found a lot of online studies. I mean, a lot, and surveys that show a big decline in church attendance, and not just, you know, in America, but really all over, mostly in you know, the Western countries. But why? Why are people leaving the church? I know why I left, you know, way back in 1988. I'm back in church, but I've heard a lot of the following: not friendly enough. I've felt unseen. I felt unheard. I don't like the music, I don't like the preacher, I was offended, I wasn't invited, too clicky. Thoughts on that? Why do people leave the church?
I've pretty much heard all of those. To me, I think it just comes down to the expectations that you have going into church, and your expectations aren't met, and so you are disappointed. So you either say, that's not for me, or hopefully you go to find something else that will resonate with you and that you'll stay in a church, at least.
I think that's a very good point. Expectations aren't met. What about you, Anna? What do you think?
Well, I'm always telling my kids, you can't look out, you have to look up.
Yes.
And I think too often we look around and it's, I'm going to let you down, you know. All of us, we're human, we're going to let you down. If you look up, God will not let you down.
Amen. And he never will.
You have to trust in him. And so that's what I'm seeing there.
You know, one of the other things I thought is perhaps, as was my case back in the 80s, they weren't rooted or grounded in their faith. And Matthew wrote this, and it really strikes what I think is going on here. But he who received the seed on stony places, this is he who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet he has no root in himself, but endures only for a while. For when tribulation or persecution arises because of the word, immediately he stumbles. You know, I love plants. I love houseplants. My mom gives me lots of starts to her outdoor plants. And you have to root them, right? You have to put them in a glass and root them. And if you try to plant them too soon, I have discovered they'll die. They will fail. You have to get a good root system. And so when I read this verse again in preparation for today's program, I just suddenly saw plants that I was trying to root. And our roots weren't deep enough or strong enough. Wendell and I were new in the church, charter members of a little country church, and some infighting started happening, some arguing and fighting and divisions. And you're right, our eyes went this way instead of this way.
That's right.
And we left the church.
That was the same thing for me. Now that I look back, it was the people. I thought God was the people. And it wasn't until after I left and fell on my face a couple of times that I realized, well, wait a minute, it's not the church I have the relationship with, it's God, you know. And I had to work on that relationship before I came back to church, and I could understand that people are people, and we need to keep looking up, just like you said.
That's right. People are people, and we do fail others.
Yes. I mean, we don't want to.
No.
It's not
no.
intentional, no. but it happens.
It does happen. Let's see. So we're talking about roots and not being grounded. But Ki, let's talk about another aspect of this. You have Matthew 15:8.
Matthew 15:8 says, "These people draw near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me."
So their heart was never in it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think we all know people that go to church and their heart isn't in it.
Right.
Because maybe that's how you were raised and that's what you do. And you maybe you go every Easter and maybe Christmas, you know, a Christmas program. But, yeah. Mm-hmm. How does leaving the church impact individuals' lives? And I thought of my own loss. Immediately, it was loss of community.
Mm-hmm. Very true. I think a lot of people don't understand the community that we have within church. A lot of people will go to church.
Yeah.
But are you a family? We talk about, you know, we're the family of God. But just like our families, you know, things may not be perfect.
Right.
Or if they are perfect, then you expect it in church, right?
Right.
So, mm-hmm.
Do you know of anybody that has left the church and a story that you could share?
Well,
and did it resolve itself?
Not yet. I'm still praying.
Okay.
But I think for those reasons, it wasn't so much that they were looking sideways, it's that they didn't have that heart connection.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't have an experience. And they would say, you have an experience? I don't have an experience.
Yeah.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
But really we need to think how it affects our world view. You know, where did we come from? Mm-hmm. Why are we here? And so, you know, if we're letting go for some of these reasons, like I was offended for whatever cause,
right.
And so you quit, what's happening to your worldview? How is that changing? I mean, we need to have that conversation,
mm-hmm.
not, oh, why did you leave the church, so much as to, where's your worldview now? And is that reasonable and logical, or is it becoming chaotic and confusing?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, and then how is that affecting your life?
Right, right.
So,
I know that once, again, just from my personal experience, once you walk away from church community, you say to yourself, my faith is still strong and I'm still going to, you know, do this and this and this outside of church. You might be able to do that for a little bit, but I could not keep it up. You know, pretty soon you got lazy, and then pretty soon it wasn't even in the picture. And then next thing you know, you're back in the world.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, the impact it had on me leaving the church community is I ended up right back in the world.
Right.
COVID accelerated the adoption of online church.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
A lot of people were watching church services online in their jammies. Is there anything wrong with watching church from home?
No, and it can actually be a blessing for the people who are homebound.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It has its place. And especially I like our church does a Zoom Sabbath school meeting so that sometimes they can even take part in the conversation,
mm-hmm.
which is
idea.
A big part of, I think, coming in and assembling
mm-hmm.
together.
Mm-hmm.
But it does also open itself up to those who are not homebound to mm-hmm. become lazy.
Right.
And then we get into a whole different
right. I think it has developed some bad habits.
Yeah.
Well, let's see what the Bible says about engaging in church. Hebrews 10:24. And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much more as you see the day approaching.
Mm-hmm.
Anna, you have 1 Thessalonians 5:11.
Okay.
And Ki, you get ready with Galatians 2:6-2.
Okay.
Therefore, comfort each other and edify one another, just as you also are doing.
Okay. And Galatians 6:2.
Bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ.
Okay. So there's just three verses. We could have read many, many more, but we cannot assemble together. We cannot comfort each other. We cannot bear one another's burdens if we're home in our jammies just watching church. Mm-hmm. Now, I know we decided that there's a good place for online church.
Yeah.
Absolutely. But don't forsake coming together. That's important.
It encourages each other. And I notice that if I'm alone and watching, I have no one to dialogue with.
Yeah.
So whatever I hear, I can believe that's the truth instead of going to someone else and go, did you hear that? Or is that what I understood? And to me, that's so important to be able to discuss it with someone else.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you can watch anything and start believing in it. But if you don't have someone iron sharpening iron, you know, to look into it, then you could go different places.
Good point.
I was thinking of somebody who is currently homebound, and they told me their church is going to come have Sabbath school at their house.
Oh,
so that
sweet.
They can still be part of everything.
So, that is super thoughtful.
You know, so we can work things around we know somebody's in need.
That is a great idea. That is such a great idea. You know, I think of a conversation I had with my mom, and maybe you've heard it because I have shared it on a Better Life before, but doesn't matter why I was talking to her. We got to the part in the conversation where she said, let me ask you, why do you go to church? And I said, I go to church to get a blessing. And she said, then you're going for the wrong reason.
Yes.
And I'm like, what? You know, what? She said, you go to church to be a blessing.
Yes.
My mom said that to me a decade ago, and it has stuck with me. We go to church to be a blessing, not to get a blessing. If we get a blessing, wonderful.
Yeah.
And I have found by being a blessing, I am
you
blessed.
Do.
Right.
But we need to come together. There's also a very powerful force at work, and we don't want to ignore this. 1 Timothy 4:1 spells it out very plainly. Now the Spirit expressly says that in latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons. Wow, talk about strong words. How can we not, you know, what is it that we need to do so that we don't believe false teachings, that we don't believe the teachings of demons? I think you touched on it right there.
Right.
You need someone to,
you need someone.
You know, of course, prayer.
You need to stay in the Word.
In the Word.
Exactly.
With the, not just open in your Bible and read, but I strongly encourage you to pray for the Holy Spirit.
Always.
To open your mind, because when you have the Holy Spirit and you open your Bible, you see it in a different way. You really
exactly.
do. You know, there's been a major shift in worship styles. It's not all bad. Certainly not all bad. Some people prefer, you know, non-traditional worship styles, like meeting in someone's home or meeting in the park. There's a church out in Murphy that meets in an old barn. You know, come together. It doesn't have to be in a church with a steeple. You know, it doesn't have to be a building called a church. Come together and be church.
Yeah, the people are the church.
Yeah, the people are the church.
Exactly.
What is the role of church in community?
The role of church in community? In our community?
Or any community, yeah.
I would say that is to bring God to the community, to share Him. And that means reaching out and helping. I mean, how did God reach people? He first met their needs, made, you know, Himself known to them, and then tried to.
And then said, follow me, right?
Yes.
I love that. Ki'i, do you have any thoughts on the role of church and community?
I agree that we're supposed to be a light. You know, and I think with Dorcas and helping other people, we are. And any church wants to be known as the community church, or, you know, be known in a good, positive way.
Right, the church that helps.
The church that helps, or the church that has a lot of activities. Our health committee has cooking classes, things like that. and they start putting the two together, you know. Mm-hmm. This is helpful, this is part of my life, this is okay, so I'm doing these things, and maybe I should come to church. Maybe, right. Mm-hmm. You know, it's all a connection.
Mm-hmm. I wonder if there's any paper trail for that sort of thing. You know, for instance, at our community mm-hmm. center, mm-hmm. somebody that needed a shower and then mm-hmm. received some food, and then maybe heard the good word or was invited to church. Mm-hmm. You know, I wonder mm-hmm. how many of those.
We actually have three or four people right now that have been met through the soup kitchen or Dorcas who are coming to church.
Wonderful.
And they're really great testimonies.
Yes.
You know, not only for the person but
for the service.
Yeah. Yeah.
My next question was going to be, you know, do you think churches that are heavily involved in community mm-hmm. might mm-hmm. see mm-hmm. more attendance mm-hmm. or
I remember new members? A pastor recently has told us, if your church was no longer operational and disappeared from your community, would you be missed? Mm-hmm. Would the community even notice? Mm-hmm. I pray that our community would notice.
Yes.
That we're reaching out to them.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right. I would pray the same.
Yeah, that's a good.
And for me, it's all about, you know, relationship. I know for a fact that churches that focus on relationship are stronger and better off. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because we need to be needed. Mm-hmm. We need to be seen.
So we need to also, I mean, I'm thinking going back within the church, we're talking why do people leave the church.
Right.
A strong, I think, way to keep somebody in the church is to have them involved.
Right. Mm-hmm. Because we need to be needed.
Yes. And if you're not involved in the church, it's like, why go?
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm. I have nothing to offer and mm-hmm. no value.
And there is something that everybody can do. Mm-hmm. Everybody's different. Mm-hmm. We have different mm-hmm. needs. You don't have to be up front in people. You might mm-hmm. be a background mm-hmm. person. But the Lord can use each and every one of us.
Mm-hmm. I agree. Do you have any thoughts, Ki'i?
I was going to say not only be needed, but it shows caring for each other as
mm-hmm.
well.
Mm-hmm.
And you just develop deeper and stronger relationships by that.
And the other thing I really want to emphasize, because often we as a species wait for someone to greet us, mm-hmm. someone to welcome us, someone to make us feel mm-hmm. welcome. We need to be that person.
Right.
Be the person you want, mm-hmm. you know.
Exactly.
Be the person mm-hmm. that welcomes. Be the person that smiles.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. What are some common theological reasons people leave church, do you think?
Any church, not just.
Any church. I mean, for me, it wasn't theological. It was attitude.
Right.
Even in Paul's time, there were people coming into the church who were pulling people away mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. teaching false doctrines. Mm-hmm. And so that can happen in our church as well. Mm-hmm. There are discrepancies in the mm-hmm. way people within our church believe
mm-hmm.
today.
Yeah. Right.
And so that can cause dissension. Oh, Satan loves mm-hmm. that.
Yes, he does. Mm-hmm. Yes,
and
he does.
So he's got those things in. And that's why we need to be in the Word so that, because he said even the very elect can be deceived.
Mm-hmm.
And where's those deceiving people is going to be within the church, much more so than somebody outside.
Because really, somebody from outside, we'd see that coming, right?
Right.
Thank you.
But it's within.
We'd know. We'd already have our guards up.
So I guess my question is if we disagree within the same church, you know, instead of polarizing, which that happens most mm-hmm. times, is can we still be friends? Can we, so you think this and I think that, but is the point still Christ loves us, mm-hmm. he died for us, you know, I mean, the big mm-hmm. topics. Can we agree with that?
Yeah.
Even if we can't agree on what color someone's robe was or something like that.
Yeah, mm-hmm. very good point. Mm-hmm. Because after all, Jesus is
the number
the
one.
The only thing we need to stay focused
That's
on.
Where I go a lot of times. It's like, mm-hmm. is it really a salvation issue?
Right.
We can figure it out in heaven, but
exactly.
to me, it's not a salvation
Amen.
Issue.
Right.
The salvation issues are important.
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
Exactly.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
How do churches typically respond to members leaving? Now, I know we can't talk about you know, every church. We can't speak for every church. I know how, you know, when I left the church, mm-hmm. it was crickets. Mm-hmm. It really was. Mm-hmm.
It usually is crickets. Yeah.
Why do you think that is?
Well, but I can give a little bit of the other side.
Okay.
Is quite often, not all the time, but quite often when someone asks to be removed from membership or I just don't believe anymore, they do the caveat of, do not contact me, don't send me emails, take me off your list. I mean, they put this wall up mm-hmm. for whatever reason. Mm-hmm. And so as the pastor or as friends or as, you know, going, do you respect their wishes?
Right.
Or do you, I want to talk to you. And yeah. It's hard both ways.
No, I think if somebody is specifically said, do not contact me,
oh, yeah.
then you probably should mm-hmm.
Right,
that
then
boundary.
You shouldn't. But yeah. but we feel a void that perhaps yeah. if something had been said ahead of time, you yeah. know, like, oh, I'm struggling with whatever mm-hmm. issue mm-hmm. it is. Mm-hmm. If they had made friends, or can I speak to the pastor or something? But instead, sometimes it just keeps going, and then it's like, brick wall, and you feel hopeless yeah. on both sides. You just
right.
feel hopeless
right.
that there's no answer, there's no anything. So that's very hard.
I'm thinking of not somebody leaving the church so much, but a student I had one time, and he was going through a lot of rough places in his life, and so the teachers of the school had decided he wasn't going to be invited back the next year. It was a pretty strong, you're not allowed to come back. Mm-hmm. I was the only teacher who said, I think we should have him back. And I still loved him. And he knew that.
Mm-hmm.
And years later...
Did he come back?
Years later, I got a phone call out of the blue. And he mm-hmm. said, my grandma recently passed away. And she always prayed for me. He said he was a Green Beret. You know, they had 24 hours to be out in the field, drop and parachute into whatever. And anyway, he said, I've changed. I mean, I've come back into the church, and my grandma's not around, but I wanted you to know because you cared.
Wow.
You showed you cared.
Wow, Anna. Well, my other question here is, what emotional impacts can leaving a faith community have on people? And, you know, just again, I find support there. I find help there. Mm-hmm. I find love there. I find friends.
Mm-hmm.
Lifelong friends. Safety. Yes.
Yeah.
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't have that kind of support group, then you probably feel like you don't belong. What strategies can churches use to re-engage former members? This was a, you know, our church has or had little cards that if you noticed a member was missing, you could grab that little card and write them a note.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Sweet gesture.
Mm-hmm.
Is that enough?
It's a start.
It's mm-hmm. a good start.
It's a start.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I'll tell you, I have gotten cards from the church, and I have gotten cards from members of the church,
mm-hmm.
whether or not I know them.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll tell you, the ones that mean most to me
yeah.
are from people, not mm-hmm. from an entity.
Right, mm-hmm. right.
So when we personalize it, there's a special church yeah. person in our church today who sends out cards. And everybody comes up at, who is this? And I'm like, oh, and I point her out, and I, you know, and I just, it fills me with love to see the love that she's sharing, that all these people are not feeling left out.
Yeah.
You know, they're getting a card, not just from an entity, but from a person. And now they want to know who that is.
It's her ministry.
It is, and it's beautiful.
That is so sweet. Why is building a supportive community within the church important? So we're going to see what the Bible has to say from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and I will start with verse 12, and then we'll just read through that and have a little bit of discussion before we end. For as the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, for in fact, the body is not one member, but many.
If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where would be the smelling? But now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body just as he pleased. And if they were all one member, where would the body be?
But now indeed there are many members, yet one body. And the eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. No, much rather, those members of the body which seem to be weaker are necessary.
Amen.
And those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, on these we bestow greater honor, and our unpresentable parts have greater modesty. But our presentable parts have no need. But God composed the body, having given honor to that part which lacks it, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care for one another. And if one member suffers, all the members suffer with it. Or if one member is honored, all the members rejoice. Mm. Now, you are the body of Christ and members individually.
So how important is church? Really important.
Very, very
yeah, so. We suffer without it. The body of Christ suffers without it. And again, church is not a building.
Correct.
Church is a group of people that come together to form this body of Christ.
Mm-hmm. Well, where two or three are gathered together, there is Christ with them.
Yeah.
Wherever Christ is, that's the church.
I love that.
So
love that.
Doesn't matter if you're home or in the church or in Walmart or wherever.
So we're having church right now.
Exactly.
Well, if you're struggling with your faith, if you're considering leaving the church, I want to encourage you with a text from Romans 12. This is verse 4 and 5. For as we have many members in one body, but all the members do not have the same function, so we, being many, are one body in Christ and individually members of one another. We all have a part to play. I cannot play your part, and you can't play my part.
Amen.
You know, we all have a part, and you are meant to be a part of it. Mm-hmm. We're all meant to be a part of it together. Well, we're out of time. Thank you. This has been a really good discussion, I think. I think bottom line, Christians are meant to live together. Well, not, you know, under the same roof, because that could get, what's the word I want? Stressful.
Yeah.
But we are meant to be a community. We're meant to worship together and to come together and to support one another. So anyway, thank you for watching Women in the Word. I hope this topic has been a blessing to you. We post all of our past episodes on our YouTube channel, so you can check us out there. And remember, Jesus loves you, and he's coming soon.